Hello, hello, and happy Easter. He is risen. He is risen, and he ever lives to make intercession for us. No matter what you're going through, Jesus himself is making intercession for you before the Father. What a comforting and encouraging thought as we start our Easter service. Amen. As always, we do start our services reading Psalm 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High, who is my refuge. No evil shall be allowed to befall you, no plague come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. Because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Amen and amen. Before we go to our worship time on this Easter service, I want us to open our Bibles to Mark chapter 16. The verses that I read to you will be from the New Living Translation, but this is the resurrection story according to the Gospel of Mark. It says, on Saturday evening when the Sabbath ended, because Shabbat is from sunset to sunset, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome went out and purchased burial spices so they could anoint Jesus' body. Very early on Sunday morning, just at sunrise, they went to the tomb. On the way, they were asking each other, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" But as they arrived, they looked up and saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled aside. You know, the first thing that strikes me, one of the first things that strikes me when I read this passage is how we worry, how everything we do in life, we manage to make it a worry moment. Isn't that true? We go through life worrying about this and worrying about that, and we're on our way to do something and we're worrying. They worried all the way to the tomb. How are we going to do it? What should be our method? How should we get that stone? That stone is large. How are we going to get it rolled away from the tomb? When they got there, God had already taken care of it. And isn't it just like us in our life? We worry, we worry, we worry. And then we realize God has already, past tense, taken care of that very thing we are so worried about. We shouldn't worry so much. We should go on our way rejoicing. Go on the way to our go groups, on the way to our Zoom outreaches, on the way to take care of our kids, whatever it is we're doing. We should go rejoicing because whatever it is that we want to worry about, God has already taken care of it. It is already done. And you know what else about that stone that was rolled away? Just think about it. Jesus did not need the stone to be rolled away in order to get out of that tomb. He is God. He could have just walked right through. After all, later on, he walked right through the closed door to greet his disciples, didn't he? He has that ability. He walks on water. The laws of nature, so to speak, he created those laws. He doesn't need that stone to be rolled away in order to get out of the tomb. That stone was not rolled away for his benefit. That stone was rolled away for our benefit, so that there would be a clear witness for us in our minds. He is not here. He is risen from the dead. Human beings like us saw it, recorded it, talked about it, spread the news everywhere. That is something amazing. And then it says in verse 6, the angels were telling the women, he isn't here. He's risen from the dead. Look, this is where they laid his body. Now go and tell his disciples, including Peter, that Jesus is going ahead of you. I love that thought, that he has gone ahead of me. No matter what I face in life, no matter what you're facing in life, he has gone ahead. He's gone ahead of you. He knows the way. He knows every thing that might cause you to stumble. He knows every roadblock along the way. He knows everything. He has gone ahead of you and prepared the way for you. And notice that the angels instructed the women to go tell the message of his resurrection to the men. And I think that's really important, because also in a few verses later, in verse 9, it says, after Jesus rose from the dead early on Sunday morning, the first person who saw him was Mary Magdalene, the woman from whom he had cast 7 demons. She went to the disciples who were grieving and weeping and told them what had happened. This Easter story, it's all the proof we need, ladies, that you need to keep on teaching your go groups. You need to keep on allowing the Lord to use you, to speak through you to all of your neighbors. You notice that the message was entrusted to women. Go tell the men, go tell everybody that Jesus is risen from the dead. That is the gospel. He died for our sins and he rose again. That is the gospel. And it always amazes me that in this day and age in which we live, until now, there are men who will walk in to a go group, a Bible study being taught by a precious woman, and they'll say, you don't have any right to be teaching this. Oh, really? The Lord himself appeared to the women, appeared to Mary Magdalene first, and she went and told the disciples. The very message of the gospel was brought by women right from the beginning. What else do you need? That women were entrusted with the most precious gospel message. And you notice that it says with Mary, she went to the disciples who were grieving and weeping. Do you know that there are people in this world who are a mess? They're going through stuff in life. They're emotionally distraught. They have problems. They have sin issues. They have stuff that's messing up their lives. They need us to show a little compassion. They need us to say, you know, I've got something that you need. I've got the gospel message and you need it. You need to know that he died for us and he rose again for our justification. You need to know that. We need to go to a hurting world with the message that Jesus is alive and wanting to be involved in their lives as their Savior. Amen. Beautiful lessons, and just some of the lessons that we can take from this first Easter story. God bless you. Happy Easter. And right now, let's stand up and worship the Lord together.
Well, it's Easter weekend again, and we're not together 2 years in a row. I'm so looking forward to when we're all together again. I have to be honest, I've gotten a little concerned in my heart, going, you know, Lord, are people ever going to want to gather together in the great services again? You know, I'm human too. I think about things like that. And then I started seeing some of your posts online where you're so excited and you saw the crowds of people for Holy Week and you thought, oh, I'm so looking forward to being when the services are full like that again. Me too. Me too. There's just a presence there that is beautiful. Well, every year at this time, I teach you the same offering thought, because Jesus said, wherever the gospel is preached, the story of this woman will be told. Jesus wanted to bring long-term honor to this woman because strife tried to take that honor and that blessing and that joy of her generosity away. The story begins on Tuesday night. Jesus has had the big, busy Palm Sunday. On Monday, he's cleansed the temple. On Monday and Tuesday, he's taught in the temple courts. He's done miracles in front of the chief priests and the scribes, and they've seen the reality of God for themselves. He's faced all the confrontations and all the trap questions, and it's been a pretty high-pressured time. So he leaves the temple courts. He comes back down through the Kidron Valley. He probably stops at the Garden of Gethsemane to pray for a while. Then he goes up that steep mountain called the Mount of Olives, travels a few more kilometers to the city of Bethany, nice safe place where he spends the night. On Tuesday night, he's having dinner at the home of Simon the leper, a man who's obviously been healed because otherwise people couldn't be there at his home for dinner. And it's a beautiful, relaxing evening until strife destroys the atmosphere and until dishonor comes into the atmosphere. The story begins with an initiator and the spread of strife. Of course, the initiator is Judas. John chapter 12, beginning with verse 4, but Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, he who was about to betray him, said, why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. And having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put in it. So here, his bad attitude. His hardness of heart. You see, he'd been a thief for a long time. We don't know, months or years. Maybe it had been a couple of years already. Probably started stealing just little bits, but then as he got away with it, his heart got harder. And now in the hardness of his heart, at this beautiful revival time, all of a sudden here comes his words of strife, his confrontation, and his criticism. You see, the harder people's hearts get, and that's usually caused by long-term corruption. They've been lying and deceiving and taking little bits for a long time. As their hearts are that hard, yeah, they don't particularly care about anybody else but their agenda. Now, the strife that flowed from Judas's heart was contagious. The next thing we do is see it in the heart of the other apostles. Mark 14, verse 4, but some who said to themselves, indignantly, why was this ointment wasted like that? Now notice, not all the 11, just some. Some who said to themselves, that they weren't saying this out loud, but the words of Judas had gotten into their hearts. They didn't guard their hearts against his words of strife. And words of strife came in, and in their hearts, they began to sit in judgment on this woman's generosity. They began to sit in judgment on Jesus's acceptance of this gift. They began to sit in judgment on the character of Jesus to receive this gift and not caring about the poor. So because they didn't guard their hearts, this whole thing has become contagious. Maybe not verbally, out loud, but in their own hearts, they had been affected by the harsh words of strife of Judas. And inside, not all of them, but some of them were thinking this. Now, the target of their strife, well, the first target of strife was Mary, the generosity of Mary. They scolded her, Mark 14, verse 5. They troubled her. They brought hardship to her, Matthew 26, verse 10. Jesus had to tell them, leave her alone, because they were all ganging up on her. Now this is Mary, the sister of Martha, the sister of Lazarus. This was a woman that they all knew loved Jesus and was close to Jesus. I mean, everybody knew how close Jesus was to Mary and Martha and Lazarus. And look at them, how their hearts had changed toward her. Now all of a sudden they're doing nothing but being critical of her and critical of her generosity. Now straight up talk, folks. The Bible is clear. This property was hers. The Bible teaches personal property rights. What God has given to you is yours. And it's you have the stewardship of it, and you have the decisions over it. It was none of their business what she did with that anointing oil. It was none of their business who she gave it to. It was none of their business. If she wanted to pour it out on a pig, she could pour out on a pig, and it was none of their business. Now, worse yet, she brought this to Jesus. And the purpose of this fragrant oil is the smell in the room. So not only did Jesus smell nice, he was anointed for his burial, but they all got to share in the experience. And they didn't care that they all got to share because of the gift of her generosity. All they cared about was their attitude. Now, brothers and sisters, she didn't need to ask their permission about anything. When people get up in your face about your generosity, you know what? It's none of their business. I remember one time I gave one of my vehicles to one of our branch pastors and just wanted to give it to them. But I wanted to give it through the church so that the church there in that area would own the vehicle, not the pastor. And one of the leaders in the church got very upset about it. So I said, okay, I'll give my other vehicle to COP. And so we took public as a family for a while. I just thought, you know what? It's none of their business. And if they're going to criticize my generosity, I'm going to be even more generous. Now, brothers and sisters, what you do with what God has given you, how you sow that seed, is nobody else's business. She did not need to ask their permission about who to give the gift to or how to give the gift. The second target of their strife was the character of Jesus. This is wasted, Mark 14, verse 4. Verse 8, why this waste? So all of a sudden, Jesus is extravagant. All of a sudden, here Jesus is, the perfect Lamb of God, and he's driving all the corruption out of the temple courts because he is not part of that system. And all of a sudden, they're trying to tie him into the corruption because he has something nice. Amazing. He's driven the corruption out of the temple on Monday. They were with him when he did it. And now they're accusing him of this extravagant wastefulness. They're challenging his character. Grabe talaga. You see, strife is not logical. When strife just gets flowing, it just gets ugly. Now, the weapons of strife are very, very easy to see. Strife demands an explanation when, forgive me, none is required. Why this waste? Matthew 26, verse 8. John 12, verse 5. Why was this not sold and given to the poor? What right do you have to ask the question? What right do you have to ask for the explanation? It's none of your business what that woman did. It is none of your business. I remember one time, many, many years ago, we were in Hong Kong, and I bought Sasha a pair of shoes. Now, you have to understand, Sasha's got long feet, and trying to buy her shoes sometimes is difficult. And I bought her a nice pair of shoes. And immediately, somebody started criticizing the shoes that I bought for my daughter as being too extravagant. And I looked at the person, and I said, why is this your business, and why do you feel that I have to explain the shoes I buy for my daughter to you? Ah. See, but that's strife. Strife feels like we have the right to an explanation. What? No, you don't. No, you don't. You had no right. They had no right to demand an explanation from this woman. None. It was none of their business what she did with the assets that God had given her the stewardship over. Now, the purpose of her gift was the Father was having Jesus anointed before his burial. A beautiful experience before the sufferings that would begin that week. And it was a beautiful thing that the Father was doing for Jesus. But you know what? None of the rest of them understood that. And because they didn't understand, they demanded explanations, not their place. Now, what did Jesus do? Well, Jesus corrected Judas and the apostles. Now, this correction, we won't get into this, but we did during School of the Cross. This correction is what triggered the betrayal and the Satan possession of Judas. As soon as Jesus finished this correction, the Bible says that then Judas went out and betrayed Jesus. Another gospel says, then Satan entered Judas and he went to the chief priest to betray Jesus. This correction. See, when people get corrected, oftentimes the anger in their heart just opens them to all kinds of demonic activity. But we won't get into that. Now, Jesus corrected Judas and the apostles. Jesus said, you know what? The poor you have with you always, but you don't always have me. In other words, God has more than one priority. God has more than one agenda. God is doing more than one thing. You know, for years, people have criticized us for building church buildings. You should be giving more to the poor. Grabe talaga. Every year, in addition to all the food that Lasi gives us that we use for the poor, it takes another 8 to 10 million a year to finance all that we do for Aroma and the poor, and then millions more and millions more on top of that for the benevolence we do for our own members. And I looked at one person and they were saying that, and I said, well, how much does your church give to the poor? Well, we're poor, so we don't give anything. Well, I said, when we were poor, we gave to the poor. There's always somebody poorer than you. But you see, people who are full of strife have a single agenda in their mind. And that single agenda is driven by their own greed. Judas was a thief. His single agenda was to get that money under his control so that he could skim off it. See, that was his single agenda. How do I get all that money under my control so that I can steal and no one will notice it? But Jesus said, you know what? God has more than one thing he's doing here. God's not just concerned about the poor. God's concerned about his son who's about to die on a cross for the sins of the world. And he wants to anoint me for my burial ahead of time. Now don't lose sight of the great truth in the middle of that. God is doing more than one thing. Yes, we should always be taking care of the poor, but we should also be evangelizing. We should be building churches. We should be making sure that the pastors are well taken care of. There's a lot of things that God is doing. Don't get hyper-focused on one thing that gives you virtue signaling. I like how the young people say virtue signaling. Virtue signaling or woke mentality. Just, you got to let everybody know what a spiritual person you are because of what you give to the poor. That's called virtue signaling, okay? I'm trying to tell everybody how spiritual I am. You have to understand God's got more than one agenda. Now, the second thing that goes on here, he then says, the story of what this woman has done will be preached wherever the gospel is told. He said, I will not only not be ashamed of what this woman has done for me, I will not be ashamed of the blessings that God has given me. He said, I don't want this woman to be ashamed of her generosity. He said, so I want what this woman has done. I want the act of generosity that this woman has shown, this story to be told wherever the gospel is preached. So Jesus would not bow to their strife. And neither did he allow this woman's joy to be taken away. Let me close with this illustration. Several years ago, I went to dedicate the home of one of our old-time members. And I'd been in their home many times through the years. And this was their dream house. Each of the kids had their own bedroom. Mom and Dad had their own master bedroom. They had a nice kitchen. And they had two CRs, one in the masters for Mom and Dad and one for the young people to use. So Dad didn't have to wait in line for all the girls to get ready. And when I got there to dedicate the house, they'd been so excited while they were building it. And when I got there to dedicate the house, I walked in and they had all the banquet ready and the guests were beginning to arrive, but the family looked more like a funeral. I said, what is wrong? What happened? Why is everybody so sad? Well, they had relatives that had just come by and spent an hour yelling at them. You should not have this. You should have given more to help our family. We're poor and you're rich and you should be giving more to help us. And I laughed at them and I said, you know, I've known you for a long time. Ever since I can remember, you have been giving to your family in the province. And I said, now they show up at your house dedication and they yell at you because you have nice bathrooms. I said, nah. I said, come here. I got the family together. And we just started laughing. I said, do you remember that bathroom that you guys had to share? Yeah. Do you remember when you didn't even have a proper toilet that flushed? Yeah, Pastor. Do you remember when you didn't even have running water? Yeah. And now you got a beautiful toilet and you push the handle and the water really flushes. And we were laughing together because, you know, we've been through a lot of things together. And we laughed about how each of the young people had their own room now. And they could play their own music. And the family had a salad to sit in and a nice dining room table that they could all sit at and enjoy a meal together. And we just laughed together. And I said, now let's worship and praise the Lord for a while. And we did. And the joy came back. Jesus did not allow strife to take away the joy of his blessing. Jesus did not allow strife to take away the joy of this woman's generosity. Brothers and sisters, in this Holy Week, there's a lot of people who have a lot to say in these hard times. You know what? Let's remember the lessons of Jesus. All right. Put your tithe in the red envelopes. Put your seed in the blue envelopes. You can't bring them to the altar. And you know me, I'm not big on online giving. I think that's preachers just trying to raise money. I'm big on worship. So take those tithe in the red envelopes and seed in the blue envelopes. Stick them in a drawer. Stick them in your Bible. In a few weeks, when we're back together again, then you bring them to the altar and you worship God. Amen. The sowing of a seed, the return of the tithe is an act of worship. Pay Meralco online. Pay your bills online. Come to God's house and honor the Father, returning his tithe and your seed. Amen.
Familiar strain, and I know I'll never shining through. And for the first time in my life, I really looked into his eyes and saw eternity, and suddenly I knew. Yes, I can see. I can see who walks with me. I can hear who speaks my name. I can feel something stirring in my heart. How his words ring strong and true, like the once familiar strain. And I know
at COP. We had School of the Cross all week long, each evening via Facebook and YouTube. If you missed it, please look on YouTube for COP Manila and enjoy this rich teaching. Next year, COP, in Jesus' name, we will do this again in person. This week at COP, we may be locked down, but the gospel is never locked down. Praise God for the online outreaches, which you continue so beautifully. As District 20 reached out, 85 souls were saved and have attended First Truths. COP Isabella saw 15 saved. COP Bulacan saw 27 saved. District 8 had 61 saved. COP Olongapo saw 21 saved. This week at COP, a healing testimony from Dr. Joy Domingo. On February 19, she was in a car that was bumped by an oil tanker, leading to a fracture of her skull, including an ear perforation. Because her patients cannot speak, they're animals, she really values her hearing in doing her work. 1 week after diagnosis, Dr. Joy went to church as usual and took her place as an usher. During the praise and worship, she was crying out to the Lord for healing. She felt something melt in her ear and immediately could hear well. Back to the hospital for testing, the doctor said it was impossible for her injuries to have healed in only a week. They even checked her emergency room papers to be sure she was the same patient. Praise God for a good report from our healing Jesus. This week at COP, as many companies go through further retrenchments, be encouraged, it will end in praise. For Gia Martin of the River of Life Choir, she was in fact retrenched by her company. But, and with God, always look for the but she was called in for interview by the same company and given a higher position with better compensation. Retrenchment turned into promotion. This week at COP, a testimony from Florence John Iniba, who is appreciating the offering thought teachings of Pastor Sumrall about laziness. With all the layoffs in their construction office, Key was retained. Key testifies that all those laid off were the ones turning in reports and papers 1 week late. It's like a page right out of Pastor's sermon. This week at COP, a double restoration from Paul and Michelle Rivera. Though going through tough times last year, they have now been able to buy a car, start a business, and a delivery service. As soon as they started their business, online orders came flooding in literally overnight. God is truly a God of twice as much, double restoration and blessing. This week at COP, our Mighty Men in Uniform held outreaches to the Army Recruitment Center, police, and fire stations, seeing 148 uniformed personnel give their lives to the Lord. This week at COP, our Sir Lord Ushers had a fun virtual training and fellowship with 378 ushers, from all campuses, including Nai, Isabella, and Romblon. They had also a quiz, won by ushers Dennis and Eve. They studied protocols for our new normal. This week at COP, we continue to rejoice with our brothers and sisters who have received harvest from the Lord. From COP Olongapo, the Naval family dedicated their red Chevrolet Captiva. From COP Batangas, the Maranduque family dedicated their Accord during the Fortress 91 attendance. The Urbino family dedicated their Isuzu D-Max, also from Batangas. And the De Leon family dedicated their motorcycle. Coming this Saturday, April 10, a specialized quarterly fellowship featuring Pastor Sumrall and Attorney Shella Beltran teaching current laws on rentals, the Bayanihan, and IATF guidelines. To participate, talk to your specialized pastor about the Zoom invitation. Join in Saturday, April 10 at 2 p.m. It will be Zoom, Facebook Live, and YouTube. And this week at COP Go 200 Churches, let's take a trip to South Carolina, USA, where our Go group there started when Brother Dalusong of Sampaloc invited his sister in the States to join their online Go group. As other relatives and friends joined, they soon asked to have their own group, and it really helped a lot during this pandemic season. But still, the Go group grew, and you know, when you are online, there are just no limits. Soon, some relatives from Canada started joining in, and another Go group was birthed in Canada. The good news spreads like wildfire, COP, as you share with your own friends and loved ones. At COP, we now have Go groups in 28 Philippine provinces and in 16 nations around the world. Happy Easter, COP! It has been another great week.
All this week, in the morning services and the evening services, we've heard about a group of people called the Sadducees. They were not as much a denomination formed by doctrine as they were a class of people that you and I would call nobility. They were from the ruling class from the Hasmonean dynasty, the dynasty that ruled Israel in between Malachi and Matthew, before the Romans took over. It was their class that the Romans called the high priests and appointed them to the position of high priest. So the high priesthood was no longer a spiritual function. It was a political function, running the country, running the Jews around the world for the Roman government. Of course, these guys had some strange doctrines. They didn't believe in the resurrection. Matthew 22, verse 23. The same day, the Sadducees came to him who say there is no resurrection. Now, that was their big doctrine. Mark 12, verse 18. The Sadducees came to him who say there is no resurrection. Luke 20, verse 27. Then came to him some Sadducees who deny that there is a resurrection. Now, when people believe that life ends at death, sometimes called today the annihilation doctrine, when people believe that, it really doesn't matter much how they live on this earth. And that's why you'll see total corruption as part of their lifestyles and sin as part of their lifestyle, because they believe everything stops at death. So who cares about eternity? Who cares about the future? Again, they are a classic example of something I often teach you, that show me a person's doctrine and I'll show you their lifestyle. When people have strange doctrines, it does change their lifestyle. Now, they came to Jesus one day and they tested him. Matthew 22, verse 23 to 27. They said, "Teacher, Moses says if a man dies having no children, his brother must marry the widow and raise up offspring for his brother. Now there are seven brothers among us. The first married and died and had no offspring, left his wife to his brother, so to the second, the third, down to the seventh. In the resurrection, therefore, of the seven, whose wife will she be? For they all had her." He said, they all had sex with her, so whose wife is she? And Jesus answered them, "You are wrong, because you neither know the scriptures nor the power of God." Now, when people don't believe in the resurrection, they're telling you they don't know the power of God and they don't know the scriptures. And he goes on and explains to them the scriptures that they didn't know, that God is not God, was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So the doctrine of the resurrection was a big deal, and it has been a greatly disputed doctrine before the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And it is a disputed doctrine since the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. I was talking with a young pastor one day, and we were talking about the resurrection, but I noticed something was a little off. And I asked him a question. I said, do you believe in the physical, literal resurrection of Jesus? And he, and then it came out he believed more in a spiritual resurrection. I said, then young man, you're not even saved. If you don't believe in the physical resurrection of Jesus, that's one of those salvation doctrines. That's one of those things that you must believe that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. You know, if you don't believe this, a literal physical resurrection, this is one of those primary doctrines for our salvation, that if you don't believe in what Jesus did for you on the cross and the resurrection, there's a lot of other things you can be messed up with on your doctrines, but not the resurrection. Now, let me walk you through just a couple of simple thoughts today. I want to start you in Romans chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God. The first thing we need to understand about the power of the resurrection, it is the power of declaration. And declared to be the Son of God in power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, the first thing you have to understand about the power of the resurrection, it is the power of declaration, that Jesus is declared the Son of God by the power of the resurrection. Now, it's no wonder that Satan hates this doctrine, because it declared Jesus to be the only begotten Son of God. It was a doctrine that was not only hated by the Sadducees prior to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, it is even fought in the church age. In Acts chapter 4, verse 2, it says, they were greatly annoyed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. Verse 33, and with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of our Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them. Now, that's the Jews. Now, even the philosophers, Acts 17, verse 18, some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him, and some said, what does this babbler wish to say? And others said, he seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities, because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. See, Paul preached the resurrection of Jesus as part of the gospel message. If you don't believe that God raised him from the dead, you cannot be saved. So Paul preached it as part of the doctrine. Acts 17, verse 32, the same Stoic philosophers, but when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, we will hear you more about this. They mocked the concept of the resurrection from the dead. But Paul was very clear. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 12 and 13. If Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. See, even the church in Corinth struggled with this doctrine of the resurrection of the dead. Again, we see the philosophers' impact in Corinth, and I'm sure we see the impact of the doctrine of the Sadducees coming through the Jewish community there in Corinth and in Athens. Now, brothers and sisters, you have to understand how powerful this is. Romans 1:4, Jesus was declared to be the Son of God in power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by his resurrection from the dead. You have to understand, this is a doctrine that is just not going to go away. Now, let me just take this a little bit farther. It is a doctrine that is considered a basic milk doctrine. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, let us leave the elementary doctrines of Christ and go on maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God and of instructions about washings and laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. The doctrine of resurrection, Jesus's resurrection from the dead is the first fruits, and then our resurrection of the dead in the future, all this is considered part of the basic doctrines of the church. And really, I come back to that first thought in Romans 1:4. It is a declaration of Jesus as the Son of God. It is a declaration before the demonic world. It is a declaration before the angels. It is a declaration before all mankind. Jesus is the Son of God, declared by the power of the resurrection. But the resurrection has more than just the power to declare Jesus as the Son of God. The resurrection has the power of the impartation of new life. It declares us as sons of God also, the new life being resurrected into his family. Now remember with me, Jesus died on the cross to take the punishment of our sins. Isaiah chapter 53, verses 5 and 6. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one of us to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. On the cross, he who knew no sin became sin for us. On the cross, Jesus took the punishment of our sins. But his resurrection on that first Easter morning, his resurrection is what imparts new life. You see, if all Jesus had done was die on the cross for us, and then he just laid in the grave and rotted away, okay, we're forgiven, but there's no change. We're forgiven, but there's no change. The resurrection imparts the second part of salvation, which is the new life. Part of that new life is justification. Romans 4, verse 25. Who delivered up for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 17 and 18. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. In other words, you might be forgiven, but you're still in your sins. Now please forgive me. There are many Christians that have a tremendous revelation of the sufferings of Jesus on the cross. And because of that, they've got a great revelation of forgiveness of sins, that we are forgiven. But they have very little revelation of new life. They're still in their sins. They still live in the bondage of sin. They're just forgiven, but they still live controlled by sin. It is that resurrection power that gives you new life, that makes you just as if you never sinned. Now, look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again into a living hope. Okay, we're born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. You see, the death on the cross provided for forgiveness. The resurrection provided the new birth. Caused us to be born again. Without the resurrection of Jesus Christ on the cross, there would be no born again experience. The born again experience comes. We're born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now notice, born again into a living hope. We have a living, confident expectation of future good for eternity ahead of us because of the resurrection of Jesus. Now, just fasten your brain on that for a minute. Not only do we have a living hope right now in this life, but it's a living hope. It'll last forever. It's always going to have a confident expectation of future good. When we lay this body down, one day this body will be resurrected from the dead and we'll get a glorified body just like Jesus's. And we'll rule and reign with him for 1,000 years. And then there'll be a new heavens and a new earth, and we'll spend eternity with him. Now, Jesus was raised from the dead. Our physical bodies will be sown in corruption and raised in immortality. All of this new life, whether it's a new life, sanctification, living not under the bondage of sin, being born again as sons of God, just like Jesus was declared a son of God with power by the resurrection. We're born again. We become the sons of God by the power of the resurrection. New life in the resurrection, justification in the resurrection. Even our conscience is cleansed. 1 Peter 3, verse 21. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you. Not the removal of dirt, not just getting under the water like taking a bath, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When you and I are baptized, and even during this COVID-19 thing, we've got these little portable baptism things set up where we change the water after every person. We're baptizing thousands of people. As you go into the waters of baptism, you go into his death and burial, and you come back out in his resurrection. And there's a change on the inside. Your conscience is cleansed from acts that lead to death so that you can serve a living God by the power of the resurrection. But let me give you one more. We talked about the resurrection is a declaration of Jesus as the Son of God and correspondingly the new born again experience of us. The resurrection releases the impartation of new life. We're born again. We are justified. We are consciences are cleansed. We have a new opportunity at life for the rest of eternity. But also the resurrection releases the power to bring healing. Now, look at this verse with me. Romans chapter 8, verse 11. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life or quicken your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. What gives life to our physical body? If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies. Now, there's so much I can preach to you about this, brothers and sisters. So much. The Holy Ghost touched Jesus and gave life to that physical body and raised it from the dead. The Holy Ghost, that same Holy Ghost power, touches our bodies today and gives life. Now, some of you just need to get a revelation of that. Some of you are fighting with COVID right now. And I don't have all the answers to all the questions. But I do know that God is the healer. And the same power of the Spirit that touched Jesus' body and raised him from the dead will also quicken or give life to your mortal body. Will give life to your kidneys. Will give life to your lungs. Will give life to a woman's womb that she can give birth. Will give life to your liver. Will give life to your heart. I mean, please think with me, please. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, if the Holy Ghost dwells in you, and he does, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. At salvation, you were the temple of the Holy Spirit. He who raised Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. Now, just think with me. Is the Holy Spirit outside of you or inside of you? Who dwells in you? Okay. Where does that life come from? From the outside or from the inside? Inside. So if you need healing in your body today, where should you be looking to? Outside? I need somebody to pray for me. I need somebody to do this for me. I need somebody to do that for me. Or do you look inside? The Holy Spirit lives in me. The Holy Spirit dwells in me. The Holy Spirit will give life, will quicken my mortal body. and he dwells in me. Now read the verse again just to solidify this. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. Let me pray for you right now. Father, too often your people are looking to the outside for miracles when the Holy Spirit dwells within them. Lord, I ask in Jesus' name, by the power of the Holy Spirit that dwells within them, let your healing flow. Let life flow to their physical bodies right now in Jesus' name. Let the life of God flow through the Holy Spirit and give life to their physical bodies. Let kidneys begin to function again. Let ears be healed. Let eyes be healed. Let lungs be open and strong. No more glass lung, Lord. Lungs open and strong, and bronchial tubes clear and whole in Jesus' name. Oh, Father, let life flow. And let that life destroy every bit of death in their body, every bit of cancer, every bit of unnatural growth. Let the Holy Spirit's life that flows from within them give life to their physical bodies right now in Jesus' name. I thank you for it, Father. I thank you for it, Father. In Jesus' name. Jesus is alive. Now let me close with this thought. I've just tried to throw some thoughts out to you today. I didn't want to teach a lot of heavy theology, because I know you want to spend time with your families today, and it's been a rough week, and we're all concerned about what happens tomorrow. Like, do we get out of our lockdown tomorrow? But I just want to give you one more thought. When you really believe in life after death, when you really believe in the resurrection, it affects how you live right now. It not only changes us and gives us new life, it changes how you think about life. Because you realize this world is not my home. I'm just an alien here. I'm just a stranger here. 70 years more for good behavior if Jesus tarries. But I'm going home. Life does not end at the grave. Every time we do a funeral, we remind people, right now, your husband, your wife, your son, your daughter, is seeing everything they've always believed in. They could never quite understand it, but now they see it. Now they understand it. They're seeing Jesus face to face. They're walking on streets of transparent gold. We're born again into a living hope. Now, brothers and sisters, when you live with the understanding of eternity, it changes how you live this life. This life is not just eat, drink, and be merry. This life is to serve. This life is to work while it is yet day, for the night cometh when no man can work. We never understood those verses as much as we do under lockdown, Deva. This life is to accomplish all we can for the kingdom, because there are no more works when we get to heaven. A young pastor looked at me one time and said, "Pastor Sumrall, you have no fun in life. All you do is work." And I laughed at him and I said, "I have fun with everything I do." And I said, "Young man, what you don't realize is what I figured out a long time ago when I got born again when I was 18 years old. I figured out I've only got a few years to really serve Jesus, because one day I will lay down my life and I'll be with him and there'll be no more opportunity to serve him. And all my rewards at that point will be fixed. So I will work now with everything I have, because one day when I finish my race, if Jesus tarries, I get to go home. Looking forward to it, but not yet. Can you imagine what it's going to be like to close your eyes and blink and see Jesus face to face? Can you imagine what it would be like to hold his hand and walk down the streets of transparent gold in heaven. Sin, it's a passing pleasure, but we don't want that in our life. Laziness and frivolity and worthlessness, we don't want that in our life. We work while it is yet day. Beloved, when this lockdown is over, we have a lot to do for Jesus. We have a lot to do for Jesus. It's like a portion of our life has been taken away. Now, Wes, we've gotten a lot done, I will admit. We've gotten a lot done in this year. God has been so supernatural to get these churches open and church buildings going in. And it has been a year of supernatural grace in the work of God. But when this is over, I will be calling us as a congregation to double our efforts, to work with everything we have within us to build the kingdom of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Happy Easter. Happy Resurrection Day in Jesus' name.